This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book in the Cards. Author, George Oliver Smith. Year, 1947. Chapter 1, The Theft. The masked man crept down the corridor stealthily. It was quite dark in the hallway, but he knew that it was a synthetic darkness, a matter of temporal convenience, for on a spaceship, time is regulated by the Terran daily cycle of 24 hours. On spacecraft, the passenger sections observe a strict 12-hour division between sheer brilliance and utter darkness. He estimated that it was a full 2 hours before light time, which meant that those couples who preferred to sit and hold hands whilst staring at the rather overstable aspect of the sky were by now bedded down and asleep. Even so, the masked man understood that with such it was not the sky that was appealing, and that under such circumstances, time was a minor and often disregarded item. So he went carefully, just in case he should happen upon such. He was lucky. There were no couples immersed in one another's dreams, and so the masked man went all the way from the auxiliary spacelock near the bottom to the B deck, just below the rounded hemisphere of seamless plastiglass that domed the top of the spacecraft. He entered the corridor that led to the staterooms, and by the dim hall lights found the room he sought. The lock was obviously intended to keep out only honest men, and the door was of the same manufacture. He took a tiny fountain pen-sized implement from a loop in his belt and applied the business end to the door. There was neither sound nor light. Silently the thing worked, and it completely removed a sliver 10,000ths of an inch wide as he moved the tiny beam in a careless square around the lock. He grasped the knob in his hand as he completed the cut. That way it would not drop to the floor and make an unwanted racket. Shoving the door open gently, he entered and closed it behind him. He took a moment to replace the square of aluminum with the lock, and with a couple of quick motions, he welded the square back in place. An experienced welder would have called the job buttering, because the patch was held by only 2-minute battens of welded metal. It could be broken out with a single twist of the hand. Then, reasonably safe from outside detection, if the steward passed, he would not notice unless he gave each door a careful scrutiny, the masked man took out a tiny flashlight and searched the room quickly. A tousled head of luxuriant hair half covered the pillowcase, but the face beneath it was not visible from the door. The masked man shrugged and turned to the wall compartment where the baggage was stored. He knew about where to look. He fumbled through 3 drawers and finally came upon a box of some 10 cubic inches. It was not too heavy, and the masked man tucked it under one arm and smiled confidently. His pen beam he used to weld the call buttoned to its frame so that it could not be pushed. He used it to weld the lock in a barred position, and again outside, he welded the patch together firmly. The inhabitant was to all intents and purposes a prisoner, until she could command attention by yelling and beating upon the door. With the same stealth that he had used in coming this way, he returned to the auxiliary spacelock. He donned the spacesuit he had left there, and looked at the safety switch that had been welded closed. He shrugged. No need of opening the switch to close the door upon it. He'd welded the switch shut, so that opening the auxiliary lock hadn't flipped the warning lamp on the pilot's panel. Then the masked man stepped out of the airlock into empty space, kicking himself away from the side of the spacecraft. At once he became a separate celestial body, and the motion of the ship with regard to his present status was an acceleration of 1 gravity, though his velocity was intrinsically that of the spacecraft upon his instant of severance. But intrinsic velocity of this nature never harmed a soul, and the action as he saw it was that the ship was stable and he was falling with Terran constants towards the tail. He waited, counting off the minutes by his watch. The spacecraft dwindled and was finally lost in the distance. Yet he waited, for the first use of his suit drive would raise a spot on the pilot's celestial sphere, giving warning. An hour later, he applied the drive on his suit, and using a small direction finder, he located another arriving ship. Using extreme care, he put himself in the course of the oncomer and applied his suit drive with extreme caution. He matched the acceleration of the other ship, matched its course, and then, by increments, let the ship catch up with him. Eventually it passed him close enough, and he drove himself through the main open spacelock. He slammed the airlock door and went to the control room. He made a rapid turnover and applied the drive to put as many miles as possible between himself and the pirated superliner. Only then did he remove his suit, stow it, and address his interest to the package. It contained a strange crystal. The crystal was a perfect cube, 2 inches to a side. From face to opposite face, it was as transparent as space itself. Even the surfaces were non-reflecting. Looking through it, one derived a sort of tunnel effect, for the surrounding faces were opaque. Holding it at a distance from the eye and looking though, it gave the impression of a 2x2 square tube made of some metal having zero thickness. A thin square, an optical illusion, marked the boundary of the optical axis. He nodded. This was the crystal he sought. He checked one of the opaque pair of faces with a continuity tester and confirmed his belief. For one axis of the crystal was optical, another axis was a superconductor of electricity. The third axis was a magnetic axis and was a perfect conductor of magnetic flux. This was harder to check with simple equipment, but the testing of the other two axes gave him sufficient proof. He nodded in satisfaction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.